The unknown explained by the still more unknown. Copyright A Circumflex Copyright 1988 by Lana Corin Cantrell and Leo Historical Press, P.O. Box 68. Lake Lemont, G30552. All rights reserved, including that of translation into other languages is specifically reserved. No part of this publication may be reproduced in any form, stored in a retrieval system, or be transmitted by any method or means including electrical, mechanical, photographic, record or otherwise, without the prior permission of the copyright holders. Originally published in the United States of America. Library of Congress number 88-071213. ISBN 9-620749-0X. Lana Cantrell was born in Salzburg, Austria and now lives in a suburb of the Twin Cities with her parents and cocker spaniel, Scarlett. This is her second book. Her first was written when she was in St. E. High School, of which she was nominated in the literary section of E. Cowboy Hall of Fame. This endeavor is her doctorate for college credit. She is a member of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, American Institute of Biology, Sciences, American Holistic Medical Foundation, Palaeopathology Association and the Ancient Astronaut Society. Her hobbies are writing, painting, sewing and health food cooking. ISBN 9620749OX. Contents. Part 1. The Theogony. Foreword page. 1. Those magnificent gods and their flying machines. 1. 2. The Wantarindra. 2-1. 3. The Changelings. 3-1. 4. The Prisoner of Eden. 4-1. 5. The Children of God. 5-1. 6. The Children of the Gods. 6-1. 7. The Three Worlds. 7-1. 8. The Androgyne. 8-1. 9. The Sun Children. 9-1. 10. The Earth Under the Lord. 10-1. 11. The Myth of Menstruation. 11-1. 12. Birth of the Blues. 12-1. 13. The Janik. 13-1. 14. Summer. 14-1. Part 2. The New World and Its Fall. 15. The World Under the Gods. 15-1. 16. The Disc of Life. 16-1. 17. The Food of the Gods. 17-1. 18. The Murder. 18-1. 19. The Heart of the Pandava. 19-1. 20. The Disgrace. 20-1. 21. Adventures in the Underworld. 21-1. 22. The Command Base of Heaven. 22-1. 23. The Taking of Jerusalem. 23-1. 24. Death of Anana. 24-1. 25. Solomon and the Temple. 25-1. Part 3. The Earth Will Be Mine. 26. The Disc of Death. 26-1. 27. The Sufa Peace. 27-1. 28. The Sons of the Gods. 28-1. 29. Exodus. 29-1. 30. After Exodus. 30-1. 31. Life in Egypt under Amenare. 31-1. 32. Amen. 32-1. 33. Egyptian Mythology and Physiology. 33-1. 34. The Aeneid. 34-1. 35, the laws. 35, 1. 36, marriages made in heaven. 36, 1. 37, the final days. 37, 1. 38, we waste in earth. 38, 1. TFFLRTY 9, the ultimate weapon. 39, I. 40, the resurrection. 40, 1. 41, the lost races. 41-1. 42, the chosen people. 42-1. 43, the Hawaiians. 43, 1. 44, Book and Dano, then Beam Me Up, Scotty. 44, 1. 111. Acknowledgements. Many thank yous to the following people and institutions for their assistance in the creation of this book and who are in no manner responsible for its contents or faults. Joanna Barry of the University of Chicago Press for her consideration. A special thank you to Professor J.B. Van Bittenen of the University of Chicago Press. Much thanks to L.J. Bolshezi, Ph.D. of Bolshezi, Carducci Publishers, 44 Lake Street, Oak Park, Illinois. Clifton Lyon Decker, editor of the National Examiner. Bo Creighton, Florida. Vafnen Green, San Bruno, California. The Jewish Publication Society, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, Mr. and Mrs. Robert Hewlett. Arcturus Book Service, Stone Mountain, Georgia. Wilson Research Library. University of Minnesota, the Cairo Museum, Cairo, Egypt, and a very special thank you to Officer Earl Board, New Richmond, Wisconsin for his generous help. J.V. Dedicated to my parents, Hugh and Jean Cantrell, and my brother, Hugh Allen. Via all of you is beyond measure. V. Forward. If is the general opinion of mankind that we must seek our good fortune from the gods but look for wisdom in ourselves, we may consecrate shrines to reason, faith, and virtue, but we know that it is only in ourselves that they are to be found. But from the gods we ask the fulfillment of our hopes of safety, wealth and success. Therefore the prosperity and good fortune of the wicked, as Diogenes so often said, absolutely disprove the power of the gods. The nature of the gods. If conscience goes, then everything collapses around us. The nature of the gods. VT. Though they may have no longer believed in the power of the gods in these late times, in the days of Chichiro, they still believed in their existence. It is the intention of this book to prove their existence and why, as in these times, they suddenly abandoned the people. This book is, I believe, the first holistic study of man and his position in the world. Looking at the popular press of science books, particularly by so-called noted scientists, it is sorely obvious that eclectic thinking is missing from them. For most of these people are studied in one area only with very minimal use of the myriads of others. How could anyone study Neanderthal man or even Napoleon without knowing what they ate, their environment, their physiologies, etc.? The issue of whether or not ancient astronauts lived is a very touchy subject with the Carl Sagan gang, as I call them, scientists who just are not studied enough in all fields. This national clique HNS, everyone believing that all scientists believe as they, but this is definitely not true. Just as with the theory of evolution, another subject of aggravation to many, but which, we will see, is very much a part of this study too. It is a shame Albert Einstein is not around today when the debate over the issues of ancient astronauts is at its highest, for he believed that man today is but the remnant of a once highly civilized and technological society. He would have sided more with Eric than Daniken and Zacharias if Sheen than the Suganites, and perhaps we would have had less quibbling over this controversial topic. I used to be rather undecided until, as a student of pathology and other natural sciences, I started reasoning that if all of what the ancient astronaut proponents said occurred were true, then there should be biological evidence of it. Taking the old texts and scriptures at face value is not enough. There has to be other evidence to collaborate it, and I believe I have found it. As I began reading the histories of Egypt, Sumer, India and Hebraic peoples, I began getting a pattern of history that no one seems to have recognized, because we have allowed the Bible to influence our research through the ages. I kept seeing paralleling stories in all Eb's texts, and a new story to man's ancient past erupted. The latest translations of the Veda, or Malayabharata, the great India epic, which itself means the great Stwai, and indeed it has been looked upon as nothing but tales, but I was amazed to see the same stories in the Egyptian, Hebrew, Sumerian, and biblical histories. How old these histories of India are, no one really knows. But they, like the Egyptian and Sumerian, predate the Bible by thousands of years. Only by the wedded bliss of the natural sciences such as psychobiology, pathology, and a score of others, can we ever divorce the true history from the exaggerations and myths picked up along the way by man as he recorded his past. This is another part of it too, for all these histories stemmed from a common source, perhaps a record of the events left by the gods themselves, and it also points to a common origin of these people. The translations of the Veda by J.A.B. Van Bittenen, published by the University of Chicago, has been a Herculean task for this man who should receive credit for a superlative job. There are many versions of the Veda, but the stories all collaborate one another more or less much as in Gnostic literature of the Bible, another forgotten source, for we shall see just why the Dead Sea Scrolls may have been hidden from us and written in such secrecy. But we are also indebted to Van Bittenen, for he disbelieves the ancient astronaut theory, which, one, is a plus for those of us who do not, for he is then not biased in his translations. There has been much debate that our government is concealing facts concerning UFOs, Hollow Earth, etc. I too was undecided in this until I delved into the past. Rather narrow-minded to be skeptical that in this enormous universe someone else would not have already gained the knowledge we ourselves are trying to seek. We just do not know all there is to know in the areas of physics and the natural sciences to make a definite yes or no to this. The Loch Ness Monster is a good example. It not so much is it believable, but is it possible? Considering the feat, we still have thousands of animals and millions of insects yet to be identified. There is no reason, and certainly not from a natural science point of view, why it could not be true. One of the big problems in science is that we have too many people voicing opinions who are only studied in mathematics and physics, and very few in the biological sciences, for this is a high-tech world caught in the last stages of its own decline, because people do not employ all the sciences together, for that is the true scientist. Remember the gorilla, the coelacanth, animals they said were extinct until they found them? It is nice to be confident about your world. It makes us feel secure, but putting horse blinders on may distract us from seeing the truth and dealing with it. It takes more intelligence to not believe in evolution that it takes to believe in it. I have found those who are fanatics in its belief remind me so of the church that has kept man in the dark for ages. I am not a creationist per se, but they have certainly hit the mark on many things by bringing up issues in science that are an embarrassment to the Suganite gendre. But to teach Such a shaky theory in schools is putting horse blinders on very young minds who should be able to explore the world for themselves. Quite frankly, this is communistic. Believe, or else you will not pass the grade. I have read scores of scientific literature on evolution and they begin to all look alike for the same reason. It is what I call the Professor Corey syndrome. I do not know if anyone remembers this comedian, but he would start talking a long-lettered, scientific jargon, emulating his old professors, until he had an audience in stitches but actually believing what he said, whatever it was. No one wanted to admit they really did not know, but he made you think you did. And this is pretty much the format of much of science as far as evolution goes. They get drunk with their words and really do not know themselves what they are saying, but with 20-letter words, anything looks good. I intend to prove that the evolutionary theory is one of the biggest hoaxes since the Cardiff Giant, and a test case in what happens when people are not studied enough in all the sciences. Whether you believe in the ancient astronaut theory or not is irrelevant, actually. This book covers so many areas of mankind from a biological and historical viewpoint. I think laymen and professionals will find it of interest. I come from the old school of thought that one must be well studied in all fields before judgments are made, and writing something to please the general public or make a sensationalized statement to gain attention is very poor research. This research will step on many toes, but as a researcher, I am not out to win a popularity contest. I have had to deal with biological truths that affect us today which have their roots in this dark past. 2. It is a sad fact in this country that most science books leave to be subsidy publicized. For sure is no public interest in improving the way of life. Every subject I have dealt with really could have had more volumes devoted to it, so this is very condensed. The problem is that the average citizen does not have the time or initiative to study anything in the sciences or medical fields and puts their faiths in the first persons who condone their paths in life, even if it means catering to their weaknesses, which evolution most certainly does. If they were more well-read, they would not be so easily duped. Evolution among scientists is not fact, it's still very much theory, contrary to Carl Sagan, whom I admire in all areas of his research, save this, and his disagreement against the ancient astronaut proponents. Many in the science fields advocate it. Our best two examples are from NASA itself. Joseph P. Blumrich and Maurice Chatelain. Blumrich was chief of the systems layout branch of NASA, a skeptic until he read the story of Skule and therein found the exact description of a spaceship and wrote his book, Spaceships of Skule. Using his technical acumen of aeronautics to discern what went on here. Another superb book is Our Ancestors Came from Outer Space. A NASA expert confirms mankind's extraterrestrial origins, Doubleday and Company, Inc. 1978, by Maurice Chatelain. The title is rather campy, which truly hides this most interesting study by one of NASA's officials who helped put man on the moon and conceived and designed the Apollo spacecraft. Now, if the ancient astronaut theory is all bunkum, why are NASA's officials advocating it? There are too many peoples in these fields who believe as do not. As Chatelain wrote concerning the Apollo flight, BUI the astronauts were no limited to equipment troubles. They saw things during their missions that could not be discussed with anybody outside NASA. It is very difficult to obtain any specific information from NASA, which still exercises a very strict control over any disclosure of these events. It seems that all Apollo-exed Gemini flights were followed, both at a distance and sometimes quite closely, by Space vehicles of extraterrestrial origin, flying saucers, or UFOs, unidentified flying objects, if you want to call them by that name. Every time it occurred, the astronauts informed mission control, who then ordered absolute silence. I think that Walter Shire aboard Mercury 8 was the first of the astronauts to use the code name Santa Claus to indicate the presence of flying saucers next to his space capsule. However, his announcements were barely noticed by the general public. It was a little different when James Lovell on board the Apollo 8 command module came out from behind the dark side of the moon and said for everybody to hear, "We have been informed that Santa Claus does exist." I, even though this happened on Christmas Day 1968, many people sensed a hidden meaning in those words that were not difficult to decipher. He then went on to tell how the astronauts had photographed various UFOs and when the first moon landing of Apollo 11 was made on the Sea of Tranquility, two UFOs hovered over astronauts Armstrong and Edwin Aldrin, who took pictures of them, which appeared in the June 1975 issue of Modern People magazine, having gotten them from a Japanese source, so it was said. The slash single quote, was even some talk that the Apollo 13 mission carried a nuclear device aboard that could be set off to make measurements of the infrastructure of the moon and three, whose detonations would show on the charts of several recording seismographs placed in different locations. The unexplained explosion of an oxygen tank in the service module of Apollo 13 on its flight to the moon, according to rumors, was caused deliberately by a UFO that was following the capsule to prevent the detonation of the atomic charge that could possibly have destroyed or endangered some moon base established by extraterrestrial trials. Well, there was a lot of talk and there still is. Perhaps we will find out why the moon may have been off limits to us to detonate such a device. We are going to find we are very much not alone. It was also said that during their flights our astronauts frequently felt as if some external force were trying to take over their minds. They experienced strange sensations and visions. What seems almost certain is that some of the astronauts did have psychological problems and changes of personality after their missions in space. Some turned deeply religious, some seemed to develop mental trouble. Facts that of course could be ascribed to pure coincidences without particular significance. The experiments in telepathy carried out in space by some astronauts have been discussed and even published. Special symbol cards of geometric figures were used to transmit thoughts from the participant in orbit around the moon to the correspondent on the surface of the Earth. Most of these experiments were successful, much more so than similar telepathic experiments conducted on Ian, which generally had a lower score. One of the astronauts who is yet doing research today is Apollo 14 astronaut Edgar D. Mitchell, who heads the Scientific Institute of Noetic Sciences to study further the issues of telepathy and other so-called paranormal research, which we are finding is not so paranormal. Then there is the case of astronaut Gordon Cooper. Tot arouses curiosity for more than one reason. He was the pilot of Mercury 9 in 1963 and of Gemini 5 in 1965, and he was unquestionably one of our most skilled space pilots, yet he never flew an Apollo. Gordon Cooper, now manufacturing diving parachutes after having quit the space program, has never told anybody outside NASA what he saw in space. But there are those who think NASA may have removed him from the Apollo flights because he had seen too much. It is also curious that this man, who is not only an astronaut but also Q scientist, has now become a firm believer in extraterrestrial life and civilizations and is convinced that space visit by Esther Ian have been around for a long time. from the most distant past up to this very day. Not long ago, Gordon Cooper brought his potted in on archaeological expedition to South America that discovered the remnants of a very old and very advanced civilization dating back more than 5,000 years. Pottery, sculptures, and hieroglyphs very similar to Egyptian artifacts of the same period were discovered, confirming once more the theory that Egyptian and American cultures had a common origin. It is quite natural for a famous astronaut to be interested in ancient astronauts, but one may still wonder whether Cooper did not acquire his sudden interest in extraterrestrial civilizations by seeing for himself in space things that he did not have the right to tell us about. 4. Why is it the Suganites deny all this while those that have been there are all moved? Body and soul? Chatelain's book, as so many by some of these authors who seem to be in the know, saw only short publication and are rather hard to locate now. As far as the ancient astronaut theory goes, there is great demand for literature here, in America, but only in Europe where the roots are deeper, do we find it as accepted by the scientists more, and the public still demands the publications. Here, it is as if a veil has been put over the people, well executed by the Suganites, who make one feel almost ashamed to do research in it until one finds out just how unschooled and uneducated they truly are. There is so much to be learned here and studied it would really take scores of years, as there are just too many questions. We laugh at star revelations in the so-called rag journals, such as the National Enquirer, which seems to be sensationalized, but that seems to be what is hiding the reason more people do not believe in them, for I have found that many of these stories do have validity behind them, but we have since birth been brought up with another side to man's history that masks all that we were meant to know. Other peoples in the world are lucky, as Zivda has been studied by them for years, as well as literature from areas of the Orient. India is finally discovering her history is much richer than ever believed. One Professor Duncan Lunan of the Glasgow University Lab has come right out and stated that someone has placed a spacecraft in orbit about the moon. This report was published in the British Journal of Interplanetary Society, which said the craft was broadcasting signals. Perhaps this was one of the things our astronauts saw. This is strange, for high the mid-60s astronomers did discover a small body orbiting the moon as they bounced radio and radar signals from it, and they went back to other unexplained radio messages in 1928, 1928 and 1934 that confirmed the same. Three other European researchers transmitted radio signals and received two answering echoes. One took 7 seconds to return, which meant it was bounced off our ionospheric layer, while the other took 15 seconds, much too logic for the law of physics to ascertain. What Professor Lunan found was that the code was a broadcast of a star map, the dots and dashes corresponding to the constellation Boots. 6. Other star maps were found by other researchers, and most believers Chatelain that the moon has been visited many times, and perhaps our Apollo astronauts found that out firsthand. Why, for instance, did we stop going to the moon with all the research to be done there? Russian astronomers have unabashedly come right out and stated Mars has man-made satellites orbiting as supposed moons. Why do many people feel the government is hiding the real story? Unless there's something deep in our psyche, genetic memory, that tells us we were once amongst the gods? Do we look up to the heavens because there was once someone there to look up to? Did someone used to come to our defense when we prayed? Are we like little kittens who, before they even are aware of birds, if you play a recording of songbirds they automatically look up? Why are such stories of the hollow earth debunked by the Suganites sheer admiral birds? Nephew has just announced a confirmation of his uncle's findings and is trying to launch expeditions to find it himself? Why do the ancients constantly speak of it? There are so many areas to be explored on this earth and in the seas below that to deny flatly anything we cannot physically register or see is very naive. The debates over the existence of the ancient astronauts are not new. The ancients themselves were in a hot debate over the issue as to the belief that the gods once warped the earth and intervened in man's affairs, and often they sound like archaic versions of harangues between Eric Van Daniken and Carl Sagan. The first of the known debates began in 300 BCE and the theory of euhemerism came into being, for Euhemerus of Messene proposed that the reason people all shunned the gods was that they once ruled the lands, and this was done in gratitude. By far, however, are the best debates in Cicero's 106-43 BCE treatise, The Nature of the Gods, the first published debate of the pros and cons of the existence of the gods I have found to date. To the Greeks, the gods were a way of life they tried to emulate. He opens the book by stating something the Sagaeans should take to heart. There is nothing worse than a hasty judgment, and nothing could be more unworthy of the dignity and integrity of a philosopher than uncritically to adopt a false opinion, or to mainly aim as certain some theory which has not been fully explored and understood. As per our in question, most philosophers have affirmed the existence of the gods, and indeed such an assertion is plausible and one to which we are all naturally inclined. Protagoras, however, professed himself in doubt on the Mela, and Diagoras of Melos, and Diodorus of Siren did not believe them to exist at all. But even among those who assert that gods exist, there is such variety and conflict of opinions that it would be tedious to list them all. There are many different theories about the shapes in which the gods appear, about their homes and habitations, about the mema of their life, and all of these theories are the subject of constant dispute among philosophers. But the crux and center of the argument is the question whether gods do nothing, care for nothing, cuts lake their ease detached from all concern with the care and government of the world, or whether on the contrary all things have been created and formed by them from the dawn of time, and will be ruled and governed by them to all eternity. So at the outset of our inquiry we are faced with the fundamental differences of opinion. Unless these differences can be resolved, mankind will continue to live in the grossest terror and ignorance of what they most desire to know. For thousands of years man had been used to having the gods around them, as this study will prove, and suddenly there was an abandonment of which these people were unprepared for. Their great-grandparents knew of them, but now the stories were very much blurred and no one seemed to really know the true story. There is no subject on which there is so much difference of opinion among the learned and the ignorant. But in this medley of conflicting opinions, one thing is certain. Though it is possible that they are all of them false, it is impossible that more than one of them is true. This is how I feel, for what if 99% of what we find in is only normal phenomenon, like the debate of the face on the moon, supposedly rock-hewn out by a higher intelligence, and also the pyramid shapes found there? What of that one little 1%? We just cannot say, yes, the ancient astronaut theory is false, because no one knows for sure. Cicero points out what Philo said, that all our knowledge is only the knowledge of six. Our own ignorance, this is what we have to rise above. Ignorance, the entire book of Cicero's is a collection of essays by different philosophers on the subject of the gods and their relationship to man. By this time in history the gods more or less reflected the weaknesses of man and his life, for they became someone on whom they could lay the blame, rather than on themselves, which we yet do today in religion and in the sciences with the theory of genetic evolution. They too found that many of The stories just got to the point of being ridiculous as man translated his own baseness into the gods from whom he sprung, as one philosopher said. So far I have been dealing in a general way not so much with the opinions of philosophers as with the fantasies of lunatics, which are nearly as absurd as the poisonous honey of glee poets. WLW present us with gods afire with rage or mad with lust, and make us the spectators of their wars, their battles, their violence and wounds, of their hates, quarrels, altercations, and also of their burglesque deaths, their complaints and lamentations, their lusts erupting into excess of evil kind. Adultery, captivity, I circumflex the intercourse with humate beings, so that mortals may have gods for parents. To these fictions of the poets we may add the wonder of the magicians, and the similar extravagances of the Egyptians, not to mention the superstitions of the novices, which are consisted only in their ignorance of tight truth. As we will see, a great deal of the above was true, but man went to excesses excusing his misdeeds of his own nature on the gods. But Epicurus believed, as myself, that a genetic memory had been forged into our brains from the most ancient of times, and for this reason we find the gods familiar and fascinating to us. The fact that people all over the world have the same legends and myths of these times displays a common source. Epicurus called this prognosis, which he wrote of in his Standard of Judgment, of the inborn knowledge of the mind that today we call genetic memory. There are many debates, as in the following rebuttal against one who denied the existence of the gods, which proves my point that we cannot deny something we have not seen as yet. Did you ever actually see a god? Cleon, why do you believe that gods exist? So let us abolish everything which we only know by hearsay or by some new hypothesis of our reason. This is as though people who dwell on land should refuse to believe in the existence of the sea. Such is your narrowness of mind that if you had been bombing Seriphus and it had never left this island, Uzir, you saw day the only little hares and foxes, you would refuse to believe in the existence of lions and panthers when they were described to you. And if anyone told you about an elephant, you would think lie was pulling your leg. Has any of the Sugnites seen God? Apparently, the astronauts did, or came closer than most. I never have, so I cannot sit here and deny they exist. I do not believe the gods came from another planet and mated with primitive man, but I do believe these people came right from here. Debater Lucilius was quick to remind all of instances which occurred, and still did, which were most unusual and which they could not explain, and which we cannot yet today. And so, both in our encounter and in Oshie's cli worship of the gods and cli sanctity of religion grow firmer aid for a day by day. And this does not happen blindly or by chance, but beckons the gods time and again declare their presence. For example, O.T. Lake Regulus in the Latin War, when Aulus Postumius was in command in the battle against Octavius Mamilius of Cassadoni, Castor and Pollux were seen fighting on horse above Hulcina ranks. And in more recent lines they appeared to announce the defeat of Perses of Macedon. When Publius Vatinius, the grandfather of our young contemporary, was traveling by night to Rome 5 in Crete, of which he was governor, two young men on white horses told him that Perses had been captured at very day. When he arrived in Rome he announced it to the Senate, whereupon he was promptly thrown into prison for contempt of the assembly. But a few words, when dispatches from Paulus confirmed the king's capture on that very day, this same Vatinius was granted lands on special privileges by senatorial decree. Again, when the Locrians defeated the men of Croton in a great battle on the river Sagara, tradition records that news of this battle was heard the same day at the Olympic Games. Often men have heard the voice of fauns in the forests, and the gods have often appeared in many forms so as to compel anybody who is not a fool or a worldling to admit that they are present here among us. They also argue how everyone had their own versions of the stories of Hercules, Apollo, Achilles, Orpheus, Hera and the family of the gods, and how they needed to find the basis of these stories for uninformed philosophers, poets and priests were making fools of the people as everyone had lost the validity of the nature of the gods as real beings. Philosophy is the child of ignorance, as the book so wisely opens up with. One thing they did argue quite adamantly over was what the gods looked like in relation to themselves, as they were the primeval design. The story was told how Dionysius ordered the golden beard taken off Aesculapius at Epidaurus, as the son of Apollo had no beard like his father, which as we will see has some truth in it. Aristotle spoke of the divine child, who had features unlike the brachycephalic and dolichocephalic features of most peoples. Everyone searched amongst the peoples for those closest in features to the gods, and we will attempt to explore the mysteries of the human body that lends credence to this. But they knew that to explore the world and its lifer forms took holistic reasoning. So we see that the parts of the world, for there is nothing in the world which is not cuport of the universe as a whole, have sense and reason. So these must be present to a higher and greater degree in that part which provides the organizing principle of the whole world. So the universe must be a rational being in the nature which permeates and embraces all things, must be endowed with reason in its highest form. They called this great power of nature just that, the power, which if George Lucas were living back then he would have said, may the power be with you. I but if said to a god, as we will see, one thing they would have turned around with their lotus eyes and said in all earnest, slash and the false, for they did not believe in fate as they were, the power, that is, the culmination of the forces of nature converge to make the whole one power Raman, or in this case as we know them, the gods, but natural beings. They felt all were personally responsible for their own fortunes in life, and this is what these debates were about as well. They believed that the earth was a living organism, Gaia, and all the universe as well, which we are finding to data be true, as it seems to teem with life. But if the heat of the sun, so stated, is similar, lowly the vital heel of light bodies of living creatures, then the sun itself must be alive. So also must the ocean stars, which are bomb entire heavenly fired, which we call the ether or the sky. They argued that because of man's falling from a higher form we could not perceive our universe as we once did. Arcesilaus used to criticize Zeno because while he himself held that all that we perceive through our senses is false, Zeno held that some only of our sense perceptions were false, but others true. This too will be a major part of this study, to see just how much we have lost biologically. It was a major topic to find those who had changed least since the fall of man from the archetypal, prima, type. And, in this biochemical confusion as we will see, everyone had their version of what the divine child would look like, and which was an integral part of these debates. And which human shape are we speaking of? How many hun beings or did some? When I was in Athens, there were flocks of young men about, but scarcely one handsome specimen to be found among them. You may laugh, but I'm speaking the truth. And to us who take pleasure in the young, following the example of the philosophers of old, even blemishes may have their claw. Perseus was charmed by a mole on the finger of a boy. A nose is a blemish to the body, but to him it was an ornament. Quintus Cachihis, the father of our colleague and friend, was devoted to Asius, our fellow townsman of yours. You may remember the verses that he wrote about Hymie a circumflex, slash, stood to greet the rising sun, when suddenly Messiah's rose were my legy hand, pardon me, gods in heaven, if I say, this mortal seemed to me more handsome than the god. So you see, to Calumus this Resius was more handsome than a god. In point of fact, he squinted then as badly as he does today. But what of it? To Coriolis it was on. Added charm. Let us return lo the gods. Are we to imagine that some of them have a cast in the eye, even if they do not squint? And tie some of LL circumflexum hovermole? And TLWL some. Are pug-nosed, some flap-eared, arid, some beetle-browed or beagle-waded, like many of ourselves? Or with them is everything made perfect? Let us suppose that it. Then are they all exactly the sum? If not, then one must be more beautiful than another. In which case not every god can hold beauty and supreme perfection. But if they are all alike, then the academy must flourish in heaven. For if there is no difference between one god and another, then among the gods there can be no telling who's who or what's what. But may it not be, villains, that it is altogether untrue. Ty, when we think of the gods we can only think of them in human shape? Do you really need lo defend all these absurdities? We Romans may imagine the gods as you say. From childhood we are familiar with Jupiter, Juno, Minerva, Nippon, Vulcan, Apollo and the other gods in the aspect in which it has pleased the painters and sculptors to present them not only in form but in ornament and age on dress. But the Egyptians and the Syrians and almost all foreign races do not see them in this way. Everyone was very confused as to what the gods once looked like. People of renown claimed to be a descendant of them and certain characteristics came to be marks of the gods, and we shall attempt to find what those hallmarks were. I have been astonished as to how so much literature has been misinterpreted by historians who are not trained in the natural sciences in the fields of paleopathology, medicine, etc. Much has escaped their eyes. Unfortunately, when someone writes a history of years past and a statement or theory becomes dogma, very hard to break it. Because of this we have missed an entire new page of man's history, and because of it we are sinking in our very blindness. The ancients tell us this is what the gods intended, but there were others who did not intend this, and as Confucius said, cognizance was the salvation of man. Let us close with the preface to the nature of the gods. If it is valuable one to follow we a single line of Argimini, how much more valuable must it be to follow out all of them? This is what the Academy seeks lo do, since its object is to discover the truth, slating the arguments both for and against all philosophic theories. This is a long and difficult task, and I do not flatter myself that I have fitly accomplished it, but I can say that I have tried. We who philosophize by this method are not just chasing shadows. I have dealt more fully and more generally with this point elsewhere, but as some persons persist in their unteachable stupidity, I have to seep on ramming it home. We of the Academy are not people who will accept nothing as true, but we do hold tight every true perception has in it an admixture of falsehood so similar to the truth, that we have no certain criterion of judgment and assent. It follows that we can attain only to a number of probable truths, which although they cannot be proved as certainties, yet many appear so clear and convincing that a wise man may well adopt them as a rule of life. To absolve myself of any prejudice, I shall first set out the views of the philosophers on the nature of the gods. On this question the whole world must sit in judgment and decide for themselves which of these views is true. I should be ready to admit the philosophy of the Academy to be a shameless fraud, if everyone were in agreement or if anyone could say for certain what was the truth. So I may well take my cue from the comedy of the young companions, and say, O ye gods, I beg you, All you Yarrick men and fellow citizens, I call on you, I beseech you, I pray and implore you, a circumflex and not about some trifling matter, such as the complaint of the young man in the play that things have come to a pretty pass when a courtesan raises is the presence of a friend who loves her. No, I am asking everyone to come into court, wait up the evidence, and return their verdict as to what we are to say about religion, piety, satiety, ritual, faith, the tousing of oaths, about our temples, our shrines, our solemn sacrifices, even about the auspices over which I myself preside. All these things depend upon the question of the existence and nature of the immemorial gods. Surely even those who believe that they have attained certainty in these matters must feel some doubts when they see how widely wise men have differed about so crucial a question. So you see the widely wise of the Blumriches and Cutleries had to debate with the Suganites in those days too. This for me has also been a long and difficult chisel too, and its merits and failings are all mine, but I have longed to know the truth of 10. Our world and why man is in the state he's in, and I feel confident that I have, but as Cicero said, it is for each individual to find out for himself and herself. The ancients said that some people could not handle the truth, and when we found out it would drive some mad. I can only say that by the research I have thus far grown in my visions of what life is, and, like Cicero, at least I can claim that I too have tried. The only way we will know for sure is when the gods themselves come and tell us. Dot. Lana Corin Cantrell, May 1987. 11. Part 1. The Theogony. Many are the stars of heaven whose names no man bis. By the same token no man knows mankind. Dot, dot. A circumflex, the words of Ica, 5th century Elephantine, Upper Egypt. 1. 1. Chapter 1. Those magnificent gods in their flying machines. To say they went uppity up up and down ditty down down is a gross understatement. They describe the very aerial machines we are trying to create today. To repute what these people describe as mental delusion has no bearing here, for the detail is superb, as was found of the ship of Skyle. The most valuable texts are the Egyptian, Sumerian, and especially Tlivda for flying vehicles. It would not be appropriate to hit the reader full face with these very stark accounts of high technology eons before ours without first an introduction to the skills they had in aerodynamics and weaponry. If ever you thought you were in the middle of a Star Wars or Star Trek movie, this would be it. It also shows how powerful mental ingrains can be, for the resemblance in these films is uncanny, as Thevda says of its history. Even as all the senses rest on the manifold workings of the mind, so all works and virtues rest upon this narrative. No story is found on earth that doesn't rest on this epic, and nobody endures without living off its food. Even as servants that strive for preferment live off a high-born master, so all the best poets live off this epic. You will find some of those great poets today in George Lucas, Steven Spielberg, Gérard Depardieu, and in writers as Eric Van Daniken and Zacharia Sitchin, who are tripping old engrams of these days past, just as Heinrich Schliemann swore there was a Troy, despite those who laughed at him, and by intuition and genetic memory found the city of his dreams. All of us, though, harbor some memory of these past times. Whether it lies dormant or not depends on many factors. In Saqqara in 1891, there was found a bird-like object made of sycamore dated to 200 BCE, and 80 years later, when it made sense, they looked at its possibility of being what it really looked like, an airplane. A team of aviation experts in the 1970s revealed that the body was aerodynamically sound, and comment was made that its shape appeared as one NASA was planning to build for an aircraft. Put to the test, it soared. It was a small-scale model. But the real thing? That is for us to investigate through these histories. Even the laser-type swords used in Star Wars are well displayed throughout these writings called the Kinderbalis, and as we will see, the duels they fought are quite reminiscent. Actors of Star Trek may think they are only acting out parts when they speak into their wrist transmitters, but a Sumerian pictograph seems to point this out with very curious wrist ornaments that seem to be not bracelets. There are bright shining birds, and celestial weapons, and horses clear taped to the sky. Those circumflexifiers thought followed the pattern of the Santa, where the gods were standing. And one of the most curious lines concerning the famous boat software, which seemed to be aircraft when one passes sat, making to stand. The hair is the name of the oars. When is the last time your hair stood on end? When a boat passed by? This profound statement alone tells us electromagnetic power was being used. The ships of the Pandava seem to be run on crystal, while those of the opposition on elixir or fuel, but all seem to use the electromagnetic powered ships when they could. Even the automatic opening doors, a last Star Trek, are used by saying a name in Egyptian texts. And we will see Scotty beaming up someone numerous times. In a passage from the day, it states that 1, 2, as Staker said, "These are these five golden channels we see before us, which stand there shining high, ablaze like flame crests?" J.G. said, "They shall carry yourselves, these golden chariots, which stand there shining high, ablaze like flame crests." Azteca said, "King, you ascend your chariots and stride wide in the sky. We shall come after you whenever our time comes." Jayati said, "We must debug all together. We have conquered heaven to get here. See how our path goes beyond the city to the exceed of the gods. These horses are quite unusual. E Thunderbolt of the Baronage is there. Steeds are the steeds I known to be indestructible. Vedava gave birth to the chariot. Steed are hence the name Sutta for those who drive the horses. Gandava bred horses. Take on any color or speed, they can be approached for any whim, and they fulfill any desire. Animus used seem to be Moorish military insignia and symbolism. Amenare of Egyptian texts called also the traveler, who does pass over and does travel through untold spaces requiring millions and hundreds of thousands of years to pass over. Thou passest through them in peace, and thou slearest thy way across, he watery abyss, to the place which thou lovest. Sink down and dost make an end of the hours. One thing we have to divorce from our minds is that these animal representations are some bizarre worship or wild mental symbolism. They drew from nature the forms they could use and which signified their behavior patterns. We have our military units through history in men such as the Desert Fox, Field Marshal Rommel, the Sea Wolves, a World War II unit, the Flying Tigers, etc. I can just see the headlines. 2,000 years from nowhere. Primitives in the I-970s were so ignorant they actually believed an eagle had landed on the moon. And some academic know-all will state, "We rose from someone so primitive. What a game we play." Hawk-headed gods seem to imply flying units, dog-headed troubleshooters, being keen and alert. The Egyptian god Seb was represented by a goose called the Say as he made his way through the sky. In its form, we should ponder whether the 12 symbols of the zodiac merely represent units who were deployed in sections of space. There are ships described which can come from water to air. You brought him back as vines in ships that were alive, that swam through the realm of air far from the water. Are not the horses that fly from which we get our Pegasus myth? Mystics have told us that the animals in Egyptian history are some great symbolism, but Vivda comes right out and tells us what they are. The vulture, the apes, the monkeys, the lion, the bulls, the crocodile and hawk are symbols of the people or groups, more basically, military units, as the Wolverines, Blue Angels, the monkey patch of the 2nd Cavalry Division in our times. My father was a monkey. The vultures, hawks, falcons, are aerial commands. No mysticism here. The apes, monkeys are infantry and artillery groups. The snakes are electrical engineers, communication, etc. The crocodiles of Egyptian hieroglyphics are represented in the Vda with the legions of Rama hoisting the crocodile flag, with its more wide open terror of flushes waved brightly on the Dakarite, sowing fear before the army entire of Sava. Animals also represented physical conditions, as the baboons, who represent those with prognathous jaws having three weak pineal glands, as baboons are known to have. Mothers hope to bear sons who shall become an India to reign alone over the birds. A heroic bird, esteemed by all the world, he will have every power in his grasp. In other words, she hopes he will become a part of the star fleet, for to reach the stars was the epitome of wisdom and manhood. Some gods, as Krishna, were called the bird-bannered god, while others had the signs of the Nibiru family, the golden lion. Interestingly, in both the Egyptian and the texts, the gods always circumnavigate their ships before taking off. In the Vda, the men sometimes circle before sitting down as a dog does, which is believed to be done to attune themselves to the magnetic forces of the earth. Some Dakarites seem to be open vehicles. The generous Matali, an expert in the science of horses, started the steeds, which speed like thought and the wind, in the proper fashion. The chariot, he looked at my face as I stood on the swinging chariot, king, and he said in surprise, "This appears to me most marvelous and wonderful today, that you have not moved a foot while riding on this celestial chariot. Evidently, king of the gods, I have always found to stagger at the first upward start of the horse, bull of the Bharatas. But you stood right there on the swinging chariot, scion of Kaliv, and methinks your mettle surpasses Sigra's. The blood from these ships we shall encounter often, and it seemed to merely be the loss of some sort of fuel, of which there were many battles over the burning pools of the gods, as in the following seems to be from an attack. When the grand bird had rid them all of life, he strode across them to look for the elixir. He saw fire everywhere, blazing fiercely. It filled all the skies with its flames, burning hot and razor sharp rays, and evil under the stirrings of the wind. Thereupon, Garuda, fierce and great-spirited, took on 90 times 90 mouths, drank up with these mouths the water of the rivers, returned with great speed, and driving the chariot of Vayu's wings, the burner of his enemies, sprinkled the burning fire with the rivers. Then, after putting out the fire, he took on another tiny body to make his Ayalai. There are many parallels in the stories from Egypt, the Bible, Sumerian, and the Vda, as Enoch of the Bible has his counterpart, as we will see in the Vda, and was take on aloft in a large celestial crystalline chariot in the sky, which it is the God's privilege to enjoy. This airborne chariot will come to you as my gift among all mortals. You alone shall stand upon a grand and skygoing Dakarite, and indeed, you will ride there above, like a god come to flesh. Circumflex, some got a little carried away by the privilege. For before, when I rode around heaven in a celestial chariot, was so drunk with self-grandeur that I did not think of anyone else. Circumflex in Egyptian. Text states, ferry me over speedily to the landing place of that field which the gods made, on which the gods carouse on those their days of annual festivals. The describes temples and halls that move in the sky which were mansions made in the image of celestial chariots, colorful, gem-studded, opulent with superb wealth. Circumflex in the Sumerian texts. Edens, were created, but they were no gardens but enclosed areas where they could reside from the impurities of the environment. The Vditu speaks of them and those that could fly. This lovely airborne city, with the splendor of good works, piled with all precious stones, and 1, 4, impregnable even lo the immorials, the bands of Gyaxas and Gangiavas, 8 snakes, Asuras, and Rakshasas, filled with all desired virtues, free from sorrow 8. Disease, was created from the Kalakyas by Brahma, O best of the Puratas. The immortals shun this celestial, sky-going city, O hero, which is by the Paloma and Kalakyas Asuras. This great city is called Haranyapura, the city of gold, and it defended by the great Paloma and Kalakya Asuras. Tlutia are always happy and cannot be slain by any of the deities, O Indra of kings, and they live here unworried, with nothing left FO desire. But Brahma has of old decreed that a Hanum would be there. Death. The relevancy of all this will come to us. One of the hallmarks of the gods was their panchan for flags. In Egyptian hieroglyphics, the symbol for the gods is a flag.